Hi everyone, Dr. J here, and in this video we're going to talk a little bit more about how you structure your decision modeling or decision making process. So again, we're looking here at this last part of our flowchart, and again we'll be filling in different sections of this flowchart as we go along throughout the semester. And we're kind of starting at the end here, as I've said before, because this is really what's motivating and providing us context by which we're going to make decisions at all these other locations in the flowchart. So we've already talked about what defines a decision. This is just to remind you that it's both conscious, irrevocable, requires an allocation of resources, and has some desired outcome or objective. And we've talked about also what defines a good decision, but we'll go into that a little bit more detail here today. So obviously, you can say a decision is best or is a good decision, but what do you mean by that? What are the relevant goals or objectives that that decision is addressing or not? And there's a quote from the book that I like, which says that decision making and uncertainty modeling are integral and synergetic processes, not a sequential set of steps here. And basically the idea is that as you're going through the process of modeling decisions, you might actually come to realize that some of your original goals or objectives maybe are or are not as important as you originally thought. So as you're going through the decision-making process, you might find that you need more information to reduce uncertainty at a particular step in the process. And once you gather that information, your objectives or goals might actually change. And so this is this integral and synergetic process part of the quote here. You have to iterate a little bit when you're making a decision. You might need to gather some more information. Based on that new information, you might change what your relevant goals or objectives are for the problem. That's going to affect the decision-making process, and that's going to impact the uncertainty modeling part. And so this will go around and around. So in reality, when you're doing this, it could be something that takes several steps, and you might have to revisit what your goals and objectives are for the problem. And as engineers and scientists, we tend to, as Dr. Karras says here, we tend to obsess with how to do. In other words, how can we do the best possible job of some task or some problem, solving some problem? And we oftentimes, or maybe sometimes, forget that what we should be doing is asking what we should be doing and why. In other words, if we are not doing the right thing, it doesn't matter how well we do it, it's still the wrong thing to do. And this is very important for engineers and scientists both to keep in mind, because we are sort of task-focused. Now, there's a point that Dr. Karras makes in the book about how sometimes good decisions can have bad outcomes. And so when something bad happens, and I'm showing here the example of the 2011 Tohoku earthquake, that was magnitude 9 earthquake, one of the largest ever recorded, caused a huge tsunami, which you can see here. And the tsunami is actually overtopping the seawall, which was built for the explicit purpose of protecting the coastal area from tsunamis. And obviously, this original seawall, which was 4.5 meters high, was inadequate for protecting against this tsunami. And the question is, looking back, was this a reasonable height to make the seawall or not? In other words, what was the probability of the water exceeding the height of the seawall given the information that was had at the time? And was this a good decision to make with this original seawall? The new seawall, which has been built since that earthquake happened, is 12.5 meters high. And you can see this is quite a big difference, obviously, 4.5 meters versus 12.5 meters. And if you go follow the link here that I have in the PowerPoint to the original website, they talk about the fact that some of the folks that live near this area feel like they're in a prison with these enormous walls separating them from the sea. And the issue here is that earthquake happened, that earthquake that happened in 2011 is an earthquake that happens every several hundred to possibly a thousand years. So the Japanese have built this seawall, which hopefully will do a better job protecting them from a tsunami next time. But this earthquake may not happen again for another thousand years. And was that really the best decision to make, or not in this case? Now, I'm not saying that this wasn't the best decision to make, or that the original decision to make a 4.5 meter wall wasn't or was a good decision, but I want to help you think about the fact that sometimes maybe these decisions, even a good decision, can have a bad outcome. So we've already talked about some terminology here, and I won't go over all of this again. I will just say, though, that there are these preferences. So this is an inherently subjective exercise determining the relative desirability between multiple objectives. This is when you have multiple objectives you're trying to meet, whether that's in the context of a city government, like the example we've talked about, whether that's in the context of building a safe infrastructure, like in Japan, or if it's some other more specific geological engineering, petroleum engineering, or geological context, where you're trying to differentiate between multiple things that are important and trying to make decisions about that. So we have different levels of objectives. So we have an overall objective of maintaining population satisfaction, and then there are various means objectives to accomplishing that overall objective. Now there's if I just go back here for a second, minimizing tax collection. So the amount of tax that you collect is a pretty quantitative measurement. Minimizing economic disruption, days of economic disruption, it would be one quantitative measurement. How do you maximize population health? How do you maximize ecosystem protection? Those are not necessarily easily quantifiable. And again, this is where your values kind of come through, is in these constructed scales. Once you have these scales, though, you can then look at how each one of your objectives relates to a possible alternative. So here is where you can compare this in this payoff matrix. What is the expected, and I say here expected, cost or value? So these things have different units. So tax collection would be in dollars. Pollution is in some specific measure or quantity related to pollution. Parts per million per area. Ecosystem protection, that's our relative scale, which we've just invented. Population health, same thing. Economic interruption in days, that's a more quantitative measure. So you can compare your various alternatives, whether you're doing a full cleanup, a kind of intermediate level cleanup, a partial cleanup, do not clean up. You can compare each possible alternative with how they rank on these various scales. And so you can see here, if you do a detailed cleanup, you get the best ecosystem protection, but you also have very high tax collection, and you have very high economic interruption. Now there's a question here of how to get these payoffs. How do you actually get these numbers? In other words, how do you know that it's going to be $12 million of tax? And here's where you have to build models. And again, here's part of this iterative process that I've mentioned earlier, where you're looking at models, you're looking at uncertainty, and comparing various model realizations. You have to get the responses from those models. And you can calculate expected costs and profits from these. So this would be a whole modeling workflow that would have to be done to get those payoffs. In some cases, you may be able to directly estimate, or at least do a preliminary estimate for what those costs will be without doing a modeling exercise. But to get quantitative numbers, you'll have to do this modeling step. Now, we also have a problem here, which is that attributes are on different scales. So we have days and a completely unitless scale and parts per million and dollars. These are all different. And so we have to normalize these in some way. And what can be done is using a value function. And you can see various examples of this here, where for this particular problem, we have, for example, tax, pollution, ecosystem health, and economic interruption, all given functions which relate. This is kind of like a data transformation, like we've talked about before, where here now we're putting all of these onto a single scale. And that scale is, Dr. Kares recommends, varying between 0 and 100. Doesn't really matter what the scale is, as long as it's consistent with all of your different objectives. So you can see here, every objective is now varying between 0 and 100. But the functions, or the way that you relate values to this consistent scale now, can be different. So for example, taxes here is a nonlinear comparison. And you can see, again, this is the type of data transformation we've done before. where a value of tax corresponds to some value on the y-axis here from this other distribution. One thing to just keep in mind while you're looking at this example is that sometimes it's easy to get confused what means what. So an ecosystem of 100 means high ecosystem health, and 0 means low ecosystem health. Whereas, for example, pollution, high means a high number of 100 corresponds to very low pollution. So here 100 is good. Here, so here with ecosystem, 100 is a high value or a high score. And here with pollution, 100 is low value. So depending on what the objective is, it might be to keep pollution low and to keep ecosystem health high. These things can go in different directions. And then, of course, we have all these directions, and we can put them all on a consistent scale now. And so now we can, so we have here our original numbers, and how do we rank each one of these objectives? And here's a very important point to make, which is that objectives should be weighted relative to how well they discriminate alternatives, not in absolute measure of importance. So think about this for a second. Let's say that you're a city planner or city governor, city government official, and you're thinking about these five different objectives. You want to maximize population health, ecosystem protection, but you also want to minimize tax collection. So doing a partial cleanup is good for tax collection, but maybe it's not so good for population and ecosystem health. What you cannot do here is think about the absolute measure of importance. So obviously the health of your constituents is probably more important in an absolute sense than the amount of tax that you collect from them. The real thing that you want to look for here is how well they distinguish between different alternatives. And so the way that you can do this is by taking the best and the worst scenario in each case. In other words, how much tax will you collect in the best scenario? How much in the worst? What will the ecosystem health be in the best and worst case scenarios? Population health, same thing. Each one of your objectives, look at the difference between the best and the worst. And again, this is on their natural scales, or if they have them, or their constructed scales, if you've had to construct scales for them. So this is not doing any kind of normalization or conversion using our value functions that we've introduced here. This is merely looking at the range in the natural value. And again, the reason for this is because we're distinguishing between how well they discriminate alternatives. So these are relative weighting. So a difference between 8 and 18 is the smallest compared to, think about this as like a percentage difference. So a difference between 8 and 18 is actually relatively smaller than a distance between 1 and 5, in the sense that 1 is only 20% of 5, whereas 8 is almost 50% of 18. And obviously 0 is 0% of 500, so here we have a huge range. That's the way these relative weighting schemes are working. And then we can do a score, where we take the rank and we assign a weight. So the way that these weights in this column are calculated is to simply take your ranks and sum them up. In this case, we have 15, and then divide that number into 100. And then that's our lowest weight. And then we simply add that to get the value of the next ranked object. So it's actually, I think the actual weight here is 0.067. So you take that, that's our 0.07 weight, double that to get 0.13. Again, add 0.07 to get 0.20, do the same thing to 0.27, and same thing to get to 0.33. And then, of course, these weights should add up to 1. And we're now filling in this table with the scores. So let me just back up here for a second. So here, if taxes was 15, the score, the value function score for that $15 million of taxes is going to be 20. These are all judgments that you have to make. How much you're going to weight various things, even the shape of these curves is all a judgment call. But once you have those, you can fill in this table with what the values are for various choices. So here's our four choices in the four columns. So now we have our standardized scores in this part of the table. We can take each one, multiply it by the weight given to that objective, and then sum those up. And of course, the one with the highest score is the one that's going to be most preferred. So in this case, a cleanup not a detailed cleanup, not a partial cleanup, not a no cleanup. A cleanup, kind of an intermediate level cleanup, is going to be the best option in this case. It's going to maximize all of the objectives that we have. But let me just say on this, so again, you've had to make a number of decisions here kind of on your way to making this decision. So your overall decision is, do we clean up this polluted site or not? If we do, do we do a partial cleanup, a standard cleanup, or a very detailed cleanup? And to get to the answer, we've had to first figure out what our objectives are and assign ranks to those objectives based on how well they distinguish between these various alternatives. We've had to come up with the values, the costs, and benefits of each of these alternatives and quantify those in some way, then standardize those scores using value functions to put everything on the same scale. And then we've weighted those scores, those standardized scores, by the weights of each of our objectives to get a final score, which we can then use to make a decision. We're going to do a cleanup. And of course, at any point in these things that we've discussed, in terms of the numbers that go in here, these are, of course, dependent on the information that you have. So this requires data. Now you have a workflow that you've went through. And at each step, you can document and justify the choices that you've made, give reasonable information, give information which allows you to make a reasonable decision about the validity of those choices that you made along the way. And then once you've gotten those in place, then the right answer just kind of comes out. In other words, there was nothing in this detailed cleanup about, well, this is going to be way too costly, this is going to be way too much economic interruption, there's no way we can pull that off. You have a quantitative comparison now, comparing each one of these alternatives based on those value functions and metrics that you have put in place in the previous steps. You can continue to dig into this, though, and compare returns and risks, and these are essentially monetary returns and risks. So tax collection, obviously, is a monetary benefit if you don't have to collect taxes. Economic interruption is obviously a benefit if you don't have to interrupt. So you can look at these particular items and weight individually the returns and then the risks. So again, the risks are, if you don't clean up, you're going to save economic interruption. But if you don't clean up, you might have pollution, you might have ecosystem health decline, you might have population health decline. So this lower table shows the return and risk metrics, where now this score here is the weighted sum, where we're using the same weights as before, but now we're just considering the factors that are in green, or the objectives that are in green. So the objectives in red are all going into the risk cost box down here, and the objectives in green are going into the return. And then you can make a plot of risk versus return. And here you see what's called the efficient frontier. And you can see here that Dr. Cares is making the point that some options might fall below this efficient frontier. And so these ones here are clearly not viable. Depending on how much risk you can tolerate, you can move along this curve. If you're okay with tolerating more risk, you might consider doing just a partial cleanup. But you would never do just no cleanup, because in that case, you're not being efficient with regard to your return. And this is something which is used a lot in investment analysis, portfolio analysis for investment firms. So this is, again, a lot of details, a lot of stuff going on here, but I want to just expose you to this and get you thinking about these decision-making practices. And then in class, we'll go through an exercise where you have to actually make a decision under uncertainty. We'll start to see how some of these things come together. All right, now see you in the next video.